to me. Can't you see? Everything I hope for, you're everything I need. You are so beautiful to me. To me, you are so beautiful. To me, can't you see?
Please do be seated. Well, a warm welcome to Holy Saviour. It's a privilege and honour to be able to welcome you here today. I've not met you before. My name is Tony, and I lead the church here along with my wife Ruth. And it's so lovely to see so many people here today to remember and celebrate Julie. I know some have travelled long distances to be here so that we can give thanks for her life together, to remember all the fun and happy times that have been shared, and to be united in our grief that she's no longer here with us. A warm welcome to those who are watching on our stream today. Our hope and prayer is that you'll feel part of today's service. It goes without saying that none of us expected to be here today. It still doesn't quite seem real. And there are so many questions, not least of all, why? Yet I know, and my prayer is, that we might all know that Julie is at peace with her Saviour, that she's surrounded by perfect love in that wonderful dwelling place prepared for her in his presence. And I'm confident too that despite the shock and the questions, God is still very much in control. He knows all that's going on, and he promises to journey with us in our times of sadness, our places of pain, and in the confusion of unanswered prayers. Today, as we gather and celebrate Julie's life and recognize the impact she had upon the lives of so many, I trust that throughout it we'll see God's presence weaved throughout Julie's life. And I pray that we might find the bravery and the strength to look back with gratitude and begin to look forward in hope too. Everyone here will have different memories of Julie, things that we remember about her, things that will bring a smile to our faces. Can I encourage you to bring those memories to mind, to hold them before God today as we gather? There will be a time a little later for anyone who might want to share a memory of Julie. Just as we begin our service today, be considering if that might be something you'd like to do. But we've come here today to remember before God our sister Julie, known to the privileged few as Mum, Nanny, or Nanny Julie. We gather to give thanks for her life, to commend her to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and a little later to commit her body to be cremated and to comfort one another in our grief. And so let's pray as we begin. Heavenly Father, gracious God, creator of life, carrier of hope, would you make your presence known among us here today? Enable us to be brave in our remembering, honest in our sorrow, and open in love and compassion to each other. Help us to seek not so much answers to our questions, but rather your presence with us as we mourn and grieve. Enable us to remember with joy the life of Julie. And yet, God, we recognize a deep shock we feel. And so, God of hope, we come to you in shock and grief and confusion of heart. Help us to find peace in the knowledge of your loving mercy to all your children. And give us light to guide us out of our darkness into the assurance of your love. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In a moment, we're going to sing our first song, one which we sang in church just a few days before Julie's death. A song that reminds us of the message of hope that is central to the Christian faith, and which we pray all people will leave here today with a real sense of. Jesus is the Good Shepherd, the one who will watch over us, who will guide us, protect us, and comfort us in our times of need. He never leaves us or forsakes us, but promises to be present in every moment of every day, from our first breath until our final breath and beyond, as he prepares a dwelling place with him forevermore. So why don't we stand together and sing, "The Lord's My Shepherd." Seated, and Keith is going to come and read for us a poem.
Hello, it's lovely to see so many people here this afternoon. The girls would say, why are you surprised? Bear with me, I've lost my page. A few days after Julie passed, I was making our bed, and I found a book on her bedside cabinet, which I hadn't seen before. Book of poetry. I didn't know that she liked poetry. But it's called When I'm Gone. And I'd like to read a poem from it if I can. So this is addressed to you, my love. This is called Again. I found myself thinking, I couldn't go through this again. But when I think about it, I mean really think about it, that's not true. If I had my time again, I would know you again. I would love you again. And if that meant I would lose you again, I would still do it. Because this is hard. But whilst I think I couldn't do it again, the alternative is never knowing you, never loving you. And that's even more painful than this. And that's how I know that I'll be okay in the end. Because I know that my love, our love, is stronger than my loss. Because I know that I would lose you all over again as long as I had the opportunity to love you again.
Keith, thank you so much. Vicky and Susie are going to come and bring a tribute to Mum.
Julie Elizabeth was born on the 21st of March, 1999. She always told everyone that she was only 25. She was the eldest daughter of our grandparents, Rita and Charlie Saviour. And Nanny recalls that Grandad was so proud of his firstborn that he knocked on each of their neighbours' doors to announce her arrival. Soon after she was born, they moved to Lichfield Road, where Mum was brought up and lived until she was married. Her childhood lives on there in the form of a brick that she wrote her name on. Nanny and Grandad went on to have two more daughters, Linda and Marie. Mum went to Bitterne Park School, and she remained firm friends with some of her classmates, especially Dawn and June. Nanny and Grandad always welcomed Mum's friends, including Tina, Mandy, and Julianne. And the garden was always filled with laughter. Mum would often be on the trampoline that Grandad made, or hanging upside down on the swing, an activity that Nanny suggested she should probably stop doing when she started going out with Dad. Mum was a keen brownie and guide, loving the outdoor activities, and she met our dad, Keith, when helping at a patrol leader training course. There followed a 5-year courtship, ending in their wedding in this church on the 10th of February 1979, that being the closest Saturday to St. Valentine's Day. Mum was nearly 20. After our honeymoon in Torquay, they moved into a house in Yeovil Chase, which became the family home for 45 years. 6 years later, in 1985, Vicky was born, followed by me in 1987. After leaving school, Mum went to Itchen College, where she said the choice for girls seemed to be hairdressing or secretarial. Auntie Linda and Auntie Marie both became hairdressers, but Mum decided on secretarial. Working first for a local plumber's merchant, Shaw Mill, where she acquired a dog named Doggy, then for British Gas, which she left in order to concentrate on bringing up a family. During the next 10 years, she had several part-time jobs: Pearson's estate agent, the Collared Dove, Ocean Clean, Vines Dairies, and Mike's Fish and Chip Shop. With her parents and sisters, she also ran a hat hire business, Lydia's Hats, for many years, though the benefits seemed to be limited to a Christmas dinner at the Concord Club and an annual trip to the Ascot races. The latter did result in appearances on the local TV news and in several national newspapers, though. She eventually found her forte as a classroom assistant at Harefield Infant School, and she worked there for 26 years, obtaining higher level TA status and eventually taking on the role of the school's emotional literacy support assistant, a job which she loved. She produced numerous toys, games, and resources to use at work and became very accomplished with MDF and a jigsaw. She produced a milkable cow with a latex glove for udders, a spaceship, and one summer she spent days making a play castle with a working drawbridge. But eventually the stress of so many children needing help led to her changing jobs. And 15 months ago, she moved to the Mulberry Bush Nursery School working with three-year-olds, another job she loved. Mum's caring and compassionate nature has been evident in many other ways. She was a volunteer helper with Simon Says, a local child bereavement charity, and was involved in the Red Box Project, combating period poverty. For 10 years, she and Dad hosted international students for Itchen College, some of whom are still in touch today. Then last year, Mum and Dad hosted a Ukrainian couple and their young son for 6 months. In December 2019, myself and my family moved into Mum and Dad's for 4 weeks, which soon became 4 months, while we renovated our new home. This coincided with the first COVID lockdown, so Mum stepped up once again and created Nanny's homeschool in her craft room, which the children loved. Early in their marriage, Mum and Dad continued with their scout and guide activities, which led to many activities, including caving, gliding, and gliding at handball, camping, canoeing, and go-karting. At the time, Mum was a brownie leader known as Goldie Owl. She was also very involved with the scout and guide show Rovering at the Nuffield Theatre, initially on stage, singing and dancing, but she went on to be choreographer and was teaching high kicks the day before Vicky was born. Vicky and I both followed this passion and performed in the show both as children and adults. This year, I returned to Rovering by co-producing the show, with Sammy and Pippa performing on stage. We know that Mum would have loved to have watched it and would have been exceptionally proud. For their silver wedding anniversary, Dad surprised Mum with a cruise on the River Nile, and this ignited an interest in travel. Since then, they have enjoyed touring China, Russia, Morocco, Southeast Asia, and last year, Turkey. Dancing has always been a passion of Mum's. As a young girl, she took ballroom and Latin American lessons and gained medals and certificates. She also loved dancing during the holiday camp she went on with her Mum and Dad and the wider family. During a holiday to Butlins, she even won a Miss Lovely Legs competition. Mum was quite a shy person, but never too shy to ask a stranger for a dance. In Hong Kong Square, in Beijing Park, Green Park in London, and a palace in Russia. She loved learning the salsa and Chirac, and even persuaded Dad to take her on a Dancing with the Stars weekend with some of the Strictly stars. Anton turned down her request for a dance, though. Mum was very keen on family history and was very proud of her links to the Parker and Diaper families of Itchen, especially with the cabin boy Richard Parker. She loved crafting and making items for her dolls' houses and was a keen member of a dolls' house club. She was a fantastic cook, often being described as a feeder by her sons-in-law, Sam and Mark. She loved hosting and always encouraged her guests to have seconds and even third helpings. She produced beautiful cakes for special occasions and her pavlovas, wow. Dad's cousin Thalia recalls a family reunion in Bracefield where Mum arrived with a pyramid of cupcakes, ensuring there was enough for everyone. For Sam and Susie's wedding, she produced 250 cupcakes of various flavours, as well as their wedding cake, complete with a Rice Krispie cake layer, because Susie doesn't like sponge. A year later, she made mine and Mark's wedding cake, and later went on to teach myself and Susie how to bake and decorate our own children's birthday cakes.
About 3 years ago, Mum took up cold water swimming with the Kingfisher Swimming Group, and the river between Mansbridge and Woodmill became her happy place. especially on a Friday when she had scrambled egg on toast and a hot chocolate with her friends afterwards. She made a kingfisher banner for the group, and she loved making fancy dress costumes to swim in, including a swan and a bottle of wine. Sewing and dressmaking was a long-standing passion of Mum's, and myself and Vicky fondly remember wearing multiple matching outfits during our childhood. Although, as we got older, I think I was definitely more keen on the idea than Vicky. Just over 2 years ago, we inadvertently started a new Marsh family tradition, where we go for breakfast at the Red Lion one Saturday a month. This was always a day we looked forward to, and we intend to keep the tradition going, the next one being this Saturday.
Mum absolutely idolised her four grandchildren, Sammy, Isabel, Pippa and Alfie. And she was at her happiest when being in their company, whether it was collecting eggs at Longdown, walking through the woods at Bear Forest, pancake making, crabbing at Handball, or at the Manor Farm Play Shack. She was really looking forward to a week's holiday with them and Dad this August. We are all so lucky to have Mum enrich our lives, and we're devastated to lose our Lady in Red.
Thank you both so much. It was beautiful memories shared. The grandchildren aren't with us today, but they have recorded some memories of Nanny that we're going to watch. Oh, they were beautiful, weren't they? Wonderful memories. I wonder if anyone here has something they'd like to share today. Just give me a wave and I'll bring a microphone to you.
My name's Jo and I'm representing the Kingfisher Swimmers. I first spoke to Julie about outdoor swimming with the Kingfishers at the beginning of April 2021. I must confess that I did my best to put her off and try to convince her that it would be much more comfortable for her if she were to start during the warmer summer months. She wouldn't be put off. She told me she wore a wetsuit, had to have a practice on the beach and was ready to take a plunge. So we arranged her first swim at 6 a.m. It turned out that her wetsuit was actually just a rash suit, which is basically made of swimming costume material and far from ideal for the cold river temperatures during April. But still she wouldn't be swayed and insisted on embarking on her first swim with the Kingfishers from Mansbridge. Oh my word, I can still see in my mind's eye her absolute elation when she entered the river and swooshed under the bridge. Nay and I likened her to a serene swan, which Julie would not have thanked us for had she known what was to unfold at the hands, or should I say wings, of the overzealous swan parents that plagued us that following year. She came back the very next morning at 5 a.m. and joined us for our May Day gathering on what we call the long, long swim. It begins at Gaiters Mill, takes us past the White Swan, through Mansbridge and all the way back to Woodmill. We had to forbid Julie to swim the whole distance that morning, owing to her lack of suitable cold water attire. Nevertheless, the long, long swim became her absolute favourite swim for the sheer beauty and adventurousness of it. For us, it will now forever be called Julie's long, long swim. Julie was a joy. She radiated with it, but also serenity and gracefulness. She was unique in her care for others and loved so much by us all.
The following are tributes from her closest Kingfisher friends. Julie was one in a million. She was gentle and thoughtful and always so caring and supportive. She remembered so many small details about us and our families, had the kindest listening ear, and gave the soundest and most heartfelt advice. She was an amazing lady with a zest for life. Julie was a beautiful, joyful, kind, creative, generous woman. She was so proud and delighted with her family and grandchildren. One of those people who brings something positive to anyone she meets. We'll remember her gentleness, kindness, her serenity and generosity. Julie shone with gentle loveliness. Her sense of creating community was instrumental in helping to shape the very heart of the unique friendship Kingfisher community that we enjoy today. Wherever our beautiful, creative Kingfisher friend is now, for sure, it must be the most glorious swim spot we could ever possibly imagine.
If I were to think of a character to portray Julie, it would have to be Mary Poppins, because she was, quite simply, practically perfect in every way. Everything Julie did, she did with purpose, poise, and passion. Who else do you know could walk a corset and have a burlesque party for their 60th? Julie's legacy will live on her head for many years to come. She's everywhere. Costumes for dance competitions, dress up for assemblies, and in her love and creativity. Julie touched the lives of so many children. she was like. The days after she died, the weather was a mix of rain and sunshine. And in our city assembly, we talked about how dreamy was the sunshine. Bright, cheery, and warm. It says a lot about how the children felt about her when, on more than a few occasions now, the children stopped me on the playground and pointed to the sky and just said, look, there she is, it's Mrs. Marsh. I'm fed good wave and said hello. Whilst she may not be physically present with us now, I know I speak for all of her friends at Hereford that her legacy will live on. Thank you.
Hello, I'm from Hereford as well. Jeannie was the kindest, most caring, wonderful person I've been lucky enough to know personally and professionally, and I will miss her dearly. She was my teaching assistant for 2 years, and I learned so much from her. Not only did she make me a better teacher, but also a better parent and person. I nicknamed her Mary Poppins because she really was.
So much. Anyone else?
My sister Julie. Julie and I always said we'd grow old together, probably in an old people's home, sat side by side but not knowing who each other was. But that won't happen now. I have wonderful memories of our childhood where we always were together. Julie would jump off the roof of the shed and I would sit and watch. She would hang upside down on the swing and I would sit and watch, a reoccurring theme. She was 3 years older than me, but we were so competitive. We would race up the driveway of the bungalow to get to the back door first. One would get in and the other would hold the door handle, not allowing the other in. We broke the glass 3 times. As a teenager, she let me tag on to whatever she was doing with her friends, skating at the ice rink, dancing at the top rank. When we left school, we both had a job in Southampton. I caught the bus in Middenbury and Julie would get on at Bitterne Brewery. And when we arrived in town, we would say goodbye and go our separate ways until the next morning. One day, as we were saying our goodbyes, a bird pooped on the front of Julie's hair. I laughed and she shouted and she was so cross with me because I laughed so much, but we never forgot it. Throughout the years, we've lived just 1 mile apart, raised our children together, holidayed together, worked together, danced together, celebrated together. We didn't swim together, but we laughed and cried together. I've been so lucky to have her as a sister. And my best friend.
two stories about Julie. The first one was after time out a few years ago, where Keith's brother-in-law, Hillary, was given a talk. At the end, a friend of ours, Sue and Ian, suggested going to the Humble Plum for a drink. And we invited Keith and Julie to come. But at the end, we couldn't see them. We didn't know if they were coming or not. But when we got to the Humble Plum, they were there sitting waiting for us. And that was when our friendship began. And the other time was at Messy Church. Julie would come with Keith and the family. And she'd always come to find myself and three others who were making all the sandwiches to bring in cake. And on occasions, we didn't need the cakes because we had so many. And I would try to give them back. And she'd say, no, keep them for another time. So they were kept for Sunday for the children at the His Kids.
Thank you so much, Pat. Okay. Anyone else like to share something? In that case, we're going to watch a photo montage tribute, a visual tribute to Julie. I'm sure as we watch this, it will spark many memories for many people.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Lord God, we give thanks for Julie's life well lived, for all the ways in which her life touched ours, for the difficult as well as the good times, for the many ways in which you blessed her life and ours as a result. Lord God, we thank you for all that Julie meant to us and the many ways in which her life and love continue to be with us. In our sadness and with thanksgiving, we remember her and hold your unfailing love and presence with us, for you are the one from whom comes every good and perfect gift. Amen. I'm going to ask Hilary to come and read for us.
Our reading is from John's Gospel, chapter 14, 1-7, and verse 27. truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give it to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not be afraid. We believe that one day each one of us who confesses Jesus as Lord will discover our final home which he prepared for us. A home which we trust that Julie has found peace in. A home surrounded by goodness, love, mercy, free from pain, sadness, and all that causes us sorrow. You see, for many of us, home is important, whatever that looks like. And it'll be different for each one of us. I loved hearing the stories of how Keith and Julie met when she was just 15 through Scouts and Guides. How their relationship blossomed after Keith asked her out at the Valentine's disco. The pictures featured a lot in their dating throughout the 5 years of dating, the 2.5 last year's which were they were engaged. And it's been so clear what's been shared of Julie's life how significant home was for her. Whether that was her childhood home in Mitchell Grove or the one that Keith and Julie enjoyed for the last 45 years. A place of sanctuary. A place of feeding, both physically through Julie's awesome culinary habits and her feeder status. But also a place of emotional feeling and nurture, a place of sanctuary and welcome, a hub of creativity, a place filled with joy and love. Home was a place that Julie lavished her love upon the grandchildren. It was the venues with her and Danny's school during COVID lockdown. Home was a creative place where maybe a costume would be created, Sue Potato, Victorian swimsuits, brownie and beaver outfits, capes, matching dresses. Whatever was needed or dreamt up, Julie could always be depended on to create something amazing, including whatever the bears or the dolls required too. It seemed nothing was beyond her talents. international students, the Ukrainian family in need of a place of safety, and countless others who passed through the door. Home was a place where Julie and Keith brought up their family. Julie loved and cared for her daughters with their much remembered phrases. I'm treating you equally, but not the same. Or I might not like you, but I will always love you. Julie was always there to talk to have a cup of tea with, to sew and alter any items of clothing as needed. Home is important. And Jesus understands that. That's why he talks of preparing rooms in his Father's house. It gives us a real sense of home, a sense of coming home. Today we trust that Julie has indeed gone home to a place that's been prepared for her by her loving Heavenly Father. But of course there's much sadness, shock, pain and questions that have been left unanswered. Death is so hard. It leaves with us so much left unspoken, dreams unfulfilled and things undone. Not least with Julie's sudden unexpected death. There is a huge hole that is left. No longer can she be seen face to face. And Julie will be so greatly missed. But I believe that in our hour of trouble, more than ever, God is there. That we're never alone in the anxieties of life. That we never have to simply try to manage things on our own. That we can always go to him as a loving father. And that even when we forget about him, he's there seeking us out. Because he loves us. The Bible passage that's read for us concludes with a promise of peace. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. It's a peace that doesn't necessarily make sense to the world. But God's supernatural peace is one that we can experience even in the midst of the most difficult or saddest of times. And so in the assurance that Jesus has prepared a place for each one of us, I pray that Julie would know now his peace. And that each one of us gathered here today will know God's great peace today and in the days ahead. Amen. We're going to sing our second song now, one we sing regularly here at church. Yeah. And it reminds us that despite whatever might be going on, we have unending reasons to be thankful, to celebrate, say thank you to God. So why don't we stand and sing together 10,000 Jesus.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing yours a song again. Whatever may part and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. The Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is
Thank you.
Mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power Christ conquered death and entered into glory, confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we entrust you to your mercy. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, who died in his life and reigns with you, now and forever. Amen. The family would love for people to stay around to share memories of Julie, to enjoy some of the delicious food that's upstairs, and to just spend time together if you're able to. Little later, the close family and friends will make their way to Essex Vale for a short committal service. But whilst we share memories and enjoy refreshments together, Julie will remain here in the church. And we want to provide a space for anyone during that time. We'd like to just have a personal moment. these words from an ancient Jewish prayer I find so helpful, and I pray and trust that perhaps they might be of use today. We remember when we are weary and in need of strength, when we are lost and sick at heart, when we have a joy we crave to share, when we have decisions that are difficult to make, when we have achievements that are based on theirs, at the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, at the opening of the buds and in the rebirth of spring, at the blueness of the skies and in the warmth of summer, at the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, at the rising of the sun and at its setting. As long as we live, they too will live, for they are now part of us. And so go forward from here in peace. Know that you are beautiful in God's sight, and that God's mercy is more powerful than all that causes you sorrow. Let the risen Christ refresh you with hope and journey with you towards a new horizon. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. We'll listen to a final song, after which the family will make their way on out. The final song